become immunoglobulin directed to the Fc portion of your own IgG. You know, you have immunoglobulin in your body, IgG, IgA, IgM, so it's a normal process that you have a rheumatoid factor in your body. Sometimes it will be a low titer, sometimes it will be transient. In our collagen vascular diseases, it will be higher in affinity. And sometimes this IgM to the Fc portion to IgG could be in our population 1 to 5%, depends on the population that you are studying. Rheumatoid factor can be high. You see on your left side, this is the rheumatological condition that rheumatoid factor usually high, or it will be associated with rheumatoid factor, lupus, Sjogren's, systemic sclerosis, inflammatory myopathies, cryoglobulinemia, and mixed connective tissue disease. Meanwhile, it's been associated with higher age, epithelial endocarditis, other inflammatory versus an infectious process, hepatitis B and C, sarcoidosis, primary silicosis, primary cirrhosis, and malignancy. So the message from this slide, rheumatoid factor can be associated with our diseases or with other diseases, just to widen the picture. So what shall I do if I get a positive rheumatoid factor? We go back to the patient, sit them from head to toe, put your definitions. If you think it's more of rheumatoid arthritis, do a CCP, which is anti-citrullinated peptide. It's usually the process of that ACPA, if you call it, or CCP, is usually that's been happening in the lung and most associated with people who smokes. They have an ACPA positive. And the sensitivity is 70 to 80%, and the specificity is 90 to 96%. So, anti-CCP is more specific for rheumatoid arthritis. So, why do I need to know, why do I bother myself with rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP? Because it's important in our prognosis. Sometimes they have severe disease, but you are seropositive. Erosive, so they leave the bones, they cause deformities, difficult to treat, sometimes not responding to the initial or second line treatment. Extra-articular manifestation, I'm talking about rheumatoid arthritis, dry eye, dry mouth, and so on. And the titers, so just a hint about the titer. What I need to know is it positive or is it negative? The titer doesn't change for, example, rheumatoid factor 200, I repeat it, 300, I will not tell the patient, well, listen, your rheumatoid arthritis is getting worse. No, just to tell you, it's either positive or negative. The titer, you don't need to repeat it if it is positive. Sometimes if it is negative, you need to repeat. So, factor of progression. For example, normal population, you went around this lecture, okay, let's do my clinical check. Let's do anti-CCP. So, normal population, anti-CCP significantly increased the risk of developing healthcare. So, if you have rheumatoid anti-CCP positive and you have nothing, you have a risk of developing rheumatoid arthritis. But nobody can tell you what risk is that. If you go to the genetic testing, sometimes with a good genetic testing, like for example, BCRA associated with the breast cancer, and so on. But there are some genes not associated with anything. That's the rheumatoid factor. So, sorry, the anti-CCP. So, what I tell my patients, you have anti-CCP positive. Why do you progress? You have clinical symptoms or just a check? If they have just a check, and listen, you have risk of development. I don't know when you're in development, there's nothing to share with you. Go be healthy and come back to me if you have cancer. Meanwhile, the patient with undifferentiated arthritis usually comes to the everything or a wheelchair, a cannabis, or most of arthritis. These types of people, including anti-CCP, but clinically they don't have the picture, eventually they will evolve in the next 3 to 10 years to a rheumatoid arthritis.
So, would you get the picture with the site?
So to sum up, rheumatoid factor, anti-CCP, is important for our rheumatoid arthritis diagnosis. Prognosis, if your rheumatoid factor is positive, you need to confirm it with anti-CCP, which is more sensitive, more specific. If rheumatoid factor is positive and anti-CCP is negative, think of other differential diagnosis. It can be normal, can have a lot of disease.
You said about the titer, you do not repeat. Yes. And that's because...
So, if it is positive versus negative. So, there is no point if you are positive to repeat the title. For example, I've seen a patient that diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis. I will not repeat it after the treatment because change it to negative will not add anything for me. If it is positive, it will tell me that I had an aggressive disease, I have to be careful.
I mean, so we don't use it in terms of like follow up or monitoring the disease.
Yes, that's the
note.
That exactly. So you use it for diagnosis, you use it for, you get point from the ACR criteria, right? For the diagnosis, you use it. You need for the diagnosis. If it is positive, it will tell you the disease could be resistant, which we call extra-articular manifestations in each patient.
Phase two. So we'll go for the internal medicine. 27 years old female comes to you, 4 years history of malaria rash, photosensitivity, you've seen it here in the picture, and she had an arthritis when she was in the world. So what's the next appropriate lab to do to confirm your diagnosis?
CRB, OBNA, and SLE.
Okay, so you think both this is straightforward, young female, she comes to you with the erosion of the rule of the systemic lupus erythematosus. So let's talk about the antibodies. So antibodies, you remember this from the biology book, what you have inside the cell. So we'd like to know if there is an antibody inside our cells or not. So what we do something called screening, ANA screening. That's mostly you do it, then we'll tell them for us to do extractable antigens. I will give another example. For example, nobody, no doctor comes from that, from the airlines. They open the doors, hope they have a meeting, and they close. So what do they understand? There is something inside the room. That's what we do in the screening. So we just look inside, oh, there's an antibody, then we report it. How do we report? We report in two forms. Number one, the title. And the title means they will do the testing and they will see, they will give you an estimate of parameter. What's the number is positive is 1 to 160. That's what the approval report was in the last meeting, you know, in South America and Brazil in 2016. So they said, well, consensus for everybody, let's take the number 1 to 160, that has been positive. That means there is something inside you or something. There are auto antibodies. Antibody antibodies. 1 to 180, 1 to 80, you can accept it if it is, for example, our girl, she came 27, straightforward. You think this is lupus, you don't think there's something else. But by the time I went to 80, come, the data fits. If I do more tests, if I was stranded, all that, it fits. So you can take it if it is, yeah, I mean, no other alternative. But usually, the correct answer is 1 to 60. Sometimes you send us a report or you get a referral, weekly positive. That's less than 160. It is positive, let's hear. So they say it will be positive. So what I need is a positive antibody, and they will give you the pattern. So the pattern, why they are that, they look inside and they will describe it to you. How does it look like? Is it nuclear? Is it perinuclear? Homogeneous? Dense? Spherical? What's the importance of that? First of all, they're giving you a pattern. The pattern is associated with other antigens that I will talk to you in the next slide, which is extractable antigens. For example, homogeneous associated with double standard associated with lupus. But for example, I diagnose this patient with lupus. I do ANA, it was 160, then tell me that it's spherical. Spherical associated with extractable antigen, anti-SSA, anti-SSB, which is important in lupus patients for two reasons, for example. They have cutaneous, it will be more severe, then it can cause congenital heart block. So patient. Now, it's giving an alarm that this lupus is severe from the skin and for the baby she is pregnant. Smith, for example, it's important. And it directs me from one disease because all these they overlap sometimes. Lupus patients, they're associated with rheumatomyositis, they're associated with mitochondria, they're associated with things. So it just give me an alarm to go back and ask the patient with a rheumatoid phenomenon can be either to lupus. present guy, he always alone, and he's curious to know. He's, oh, that's a rheumatologist, that's an internist, a doctor. So I need to know precisely who inside the room. That's the exam. I need to know exactly what's inside the cell. And positive, whatever the pattern is, I need to know. For example, in lupus, the associate, we run all of them, and we see what's associated. As I said, SMET, for example, is associated with kidney, so I have to make sure that there is kidney getting more often for the SMET patient. Or lab, as I said, skin and transfer to the fetus. When you look at heart block, rheumatoid arthritis can associate with Sjogren, anti-ra, diffuse systemic sclerosis, anti-CD70, and associated with interstitial lung disease. Limited sclerosis, Mercury syndrome, associated with centromere, and associated with pulmonary hypertension, polymyositis, associated with anti-GO, tissue disease, which is an entity that an RME usually positive 100% of our patients. So ANA is important as a screening. If I have a photo of antibodies, 1 to 160 to the cut. The pattern is important because it directs me, and the extractable, we do them. In practice, what we order, we order ANA. If the ANA is positive, automatically, what we did is in bar or in Sabah, to look at the two and neurological lab, they automatically, they will run the DNA. But sometimes, the patient has confusion, I think this patient has something, I need to order specifically, so I write in my request. ANA was positive, then we did negative, I need to do an ANA, please do me the full panel that you have. Then they will run it for you.
I
found
this one.
If
it's weekly positive,
it's 60,
but if it's weekly positive,
do
they run
the
ANA?
No. Weekly positive, they don't run the ANA.
Do I consider weekly positive?
It's weekly positive.
Do I consider it weakly positive?
So that's the question. If you consider it weakly positive, think to the clinical picture. You still suspect this is a connective tissue disease, there are no other, you can't do it. Then the remit usually after 2 to 3 months. Because after 1 month, the lab will refuse because still there's an inflammation, there is something going on, you have to repeat it. And it differs limited from lab to another. So usually I prefer to repeat it to the same lab. Just to make sure it's not a technical.
Usually in the hospital, you ask the better of ANA?
No, so you ask them for ANA.
Yes.
I write an ANA screen, and in the lab, if it is positive, they will give you ANA positive, better, then they will run the ANA for you. That's automatically. For example, earlier, I put you in test 2, lupus, most likely the ANA will be positive, will be 1, 2, 3, 20 or 460, dense or speckle pattern, double stranded will be high, whole R will be high, Smith will be high, so that's what that's the way that's been done. For example, if I send the same patient, and it's only weakly positive, I say, okay, let's treat her and then let's repeat it later, after 3, 4 months and see. Because sometimes serologically differ from the clinical picture. Sometimes serologically active, clinically quiescent, or the vice versa. Let's go for case 3. Do you have a neurology here?
Okay. 33 years old male, asthmatic, 5 years since childhood, 5 years. Short because sinusitis, right sided would drop. What is the appropriate lab list to compare the diagnosis? Ace level, HDA27, MCAT, or high growth?
Okay.
So you go.
Ask for
a neurologist.
that, and